Hello, Bitches and Clowns, Ryan Legere here. Welcome back to my playthrough of Jurassic World Evolution. And now, without further ado, let us begin. Oh, wait a minute. Sorry, I have my cue cards all mixed up. Okay, here we go. Hello, Bitches and Clowns, Ryan Legere here. Welcome back to underrated, underappreciated, underreviewed movies. And welcome to my first installment of anime. We're all throughout the month of May, we review anime. Hence the name. And by we, I mean me. Now, it may surprise a lot of you that I fucking love Digimon.
Yeah, I know what you're thinking. What, Digimon, that Pokemon clone from the late 90s and early 2000s? No, I'm talking about that Tamagotchi clone from the late 90s and early 2000s. Yes, Bandai, the co-owners of the franchise, also created the virtual pets Tamagotchi, which were targeted to the girl demographic, and wanted to create a spin-off targeted to the boy demographic. And thus, Digimon was born. Then they saw potential in the franchise and decided to expand it with action figures, video games, and a TV series. That's not what our focus is on today.
Our focus is on what many people believe to be the bane of the existence of the franchise itself. The Digimon movie. Keep on saying
anything, can't separate from Released back in the year 2000 on the 6th of October, Digimon the movie was the first and only Digimon movie to get a theatrical release in North America, for the sole purpose of duplicating the success of the first Pokemon movie. I used to think this was the greatest movie ever.
20 years later, I still have my VHS copy, which I borrowed from my cousins, and have yet to return it. Still. Oh jeez, I hope they're not watching.
But then I grew up and realized how alone I was in the universe.
What a piece of cock a dick! I know nothing about this show, and this movie didn't do anything to fix that. All it did was turn me off to it even more.
This film is a disaster. This is literally the worst example of an English adaptation to an anime.
The purest and most obnoxious of cash-ins that takes the worst aspects of the show and blows them up tenfold in the hopes of making a quick buck for Fox.
Digimon the movie is a dumpster fire.
Oh my god, this is the greatest movie I've ever seen in my life!
Recently, the franchise has been going through a bit of a renaissance, with newer, better video games, the Tri-Series, The Last Evolution movie, the 2020 reboot, and a new card game coming out. I thought it'd be nice to revisit what many people believe to be the black sheep of the franchise, analyzing what about it worked, what didn't work, and how it may be better than most people think.
Well, let's not waste any more time, let's get right into Digimon the movie. Ha ha ha! There's nothing in here. I cheated you. I cheated all of you, and you didn't even know it. It's on YouTube anyway, so I'll just, where's the remote?
No way, I got the title wrong. It's not Digimon the movie, it's
Digital Monsters Digimon the movie.
This is it, DigiPal. In a few seconds, the doors.
Oh, yeah. This damn thing.
For those of you who don't know, Angela Anaconda was a Canadian TV show produced by Teletoon and picked up in the US by Fox Kids. And I guess it was so popular on Fox Kids that it became part of the network's
identity. Shit like this makes me ashamed to be Canadian. Besides, you know, these. Happy thoughts, Ryan. Happy thoughts, happy thoughts, happy thoughts. Oh, Jesus.
So yeah, the plot is that Angela Anaconda and his friends are going to see the Digimon movie in the theaters, but they get thwarted by Nanette Namwar. So she fantasizes about digivolving.
You know what? Life is too precious. It's not worth the time.
Who says there's no such thing as monsters? You're never quite the same after you meet your first Digimon.
Best opening ever. Or at least it would be if that's how it actually opened, except it didn't open like that, it opened like this.
I know what you're thinking. What's wrong? It's just the Digimon theme song.
Except it's not the Digimon theme song, it's the Digi-Rap.
The Digivolution is up and running. Did you see? Did you hear? Did you know what's coming? A Digi-Destiny starts spinning. Let me hear you say!
They could have done that killer opening, but instead they decided to go with this. It's not even tasteful credits. You literally have to sit here and watch this nothing. That is the opening credits sequence. There's nothing to see. There's nothing to do but to wait for it to finish. They could have literally hired an intern to come up with an idea and execute it in less than one afternoon.
The background looks like an 80s computer tutorial for kids.
No effort put in this whatsoever. Look out! One of them almost looked three-dimensional for a second there! Give Angela and Anaconda some credit, at least their flying JPEGs actually looked alive.
Us at first, but we've added a few members since then. That's me with TK, another one of the
Exposition Russian ASAP.
Did you know there are actually two worlds? Our world and the digital world. Now don't plan a vacation there. I'm not even sure where it is. But when I first saw it, I was so scared, I was so nervous, I was so cute.
Bitch, I'm adorable.
The younger versions of Tai and Kari, two characters from the TV show, witnessed a computer egg coming out of their computer one night.
Hey, wake up! Tai! I'm going to the health food store! Take care of your sister!
But Mom!
Hooray for child neglect!
This image right here is fucking adorable. I love these scenes with Tai and Kari and the egg. They're sweet and innocent. Kari has a lot of personality despite only communicating through her whistle. The one thing that seems to split people is the humor. It's either hit or miss. And the ones that miss, well...
Anybody asks where that weird-looking head came from? Let's tell them our chicken coop is on a nuclear waste dump. Or Polly want a cracker? A really big cracker?
If you want my personal opinion, the ones that miss aren't that bad in the first half of the movie.
Hear me out.
They're corny, no denying that, but... At the same time, that's the kind of joke I can see a small kid making. Legitimately. It actually gives you the sense of their age. No adult would ever say those jokes.
What, did you think the writers got off on this kind of humor?
First of all, that kind of humor can actually reach kids. Secondly, it demonstrates that they are kids. No, these jokes aren't laugh out loud funny, but at the same time, it makes it very clear to me that they're children. Also, this moment right here is freaking adorable.
Don't make it sick. Hey, those are mine. Thanks a lot. Well, now that it's here, how do we get rid of it? We can't keep it. Where's it gonna sleep? Oh no, not in my bed. Fine, then it sleeps on the couch. There's something wrong with her phone. Perfect timing. That's weird. All the electronic stuff in the house is going nuts. Ah, Kari, look out!
Hmm?
It changed. It got bigger. What did you do? It can't get any worse. It just got worse.
Okay, that is entirely bad.
To be fair, the Japanese were staying true to the source of material. Yeah, I'm not even joking. The Gigapets did that and the video games did that. The fucking video games.
2009, 2010, 2000. You better pin his ears back so they don't get in the food. Boy, he looks pretty hungry.
That is the last thing we see before we die.
Say what you will about Kari's narration, this part got a chuckle at me.
He had a strange way of showing his appreciation.
But then it continued to exist. And I was gonna make an alien facehugger joke here, but I realized Coromon has more in common with Kevin Spacey than Xenomorph.
His breath stinks! Out of here!
Their cat attacks Coromon and Tai tries to save him, to disastrous results.
We don't make much of a tag team, do we?
Kids, I made your favorite, liver sticks.
Great. In a minute. We're in luck. She burned them.
Oh, by the way, there's this running joke throughout the entire movie that their mom doesn't know how to cook.
So do you have a name?
Coromon!
Coromon, what are you anyway?
You better say more than your name, otherwise I'm throwing you in the garbage with the yellow rat.
Now every time that thing changed shape, or what we now call Digivolved, there was a weird electrical surge throughout the city.
Wow, thanks for not letting us figure that out for ourselves.
Of course, there was only one way to get Tai's attention.
Why is whistling the only way? We saw earlier that you could form sentences. How hard is it to say, Tai, something's wrong with Coromon?
I'm up! What? Coromon? What's the matter with him, Kari? Is he sick?
Oh. You should know that this Coromon isn't the one we became friends with.
Coromon digivolves into Agumon and starts to rampage throughout Idenview and Terrence.
Kari, no!
These next few scenes are fun to watch. Agumon and Kari have a nice cute little dynamic, and the animation is frickin' awesome.
Just one each.
Heads up, this is the funniest joke in the entire movie.
Did you see that?
No, I was sleeping.
But you're driving!
Then shit goes south faster than a cheetah.
Do that ride again?
But Agumon's destruction is interrupted when trouble arises in the form of an ultimate level Digimon named Parrotmon, who I could have sworn was dubbed by Gilbert Godfrey.
My turn! That would be a problem.
Wouldn't be the first time he voiced an annoying bird.
Sauron? Sonic? Samus? Salmon? Sarah? Shannon? Sullivan? Solomon? We'll get back to that.
Just when you think the odds are against Agumon, Agumon digivolves into Greymon to protect the kids, which acts as somewhat of a parallel to when Tai saved Coromon from the cat earlier. Which I find strange, seeing how Agumon barely acknowledged their existence when he became Agumon, and then suddenly he wants to protect them from Parrotmon. Then again, they weren't in any danger before Parrotmon showed up. At least I hope not. Hell, why didn't he digivolve into Agumon when the cat attacked him? But I digress. Greymon, after saving the kids, goes head-to-head with Parrotmon. Fuck yes!
Doesn't get any bigger than that!
The budget for the TV show wasn't very high, so the animation was pretty choppy in some places. Therefore, the size and scope of the fight scenes were never fully realized to their full potential. So you can probably imagine how much of a thrill this was for North American fans of the show to witness this, especially
up on the big screen.
I mean, look at this shot of Greymon walking over the kids. Everything from the low angle shots to the fast-paced action, it feels more like a traditional kaiju film than
your folks will get kinda worried.
Every Godzilla film in the Showa series. Also, this is my favorite shot in the movie right here. I'll admit the close-ups of Tai and Kari do get a little awkward here and there. Also, I only realized very recently that Greymon's Nova Flame ripped off one of Parrotmon's wings.
I can't believe it! I just don't believe it! Look at this! Look at this! I'm so ticked off that I'm molting!
And then I stuffed the crackers down his throat!
Parrotmon seems to have Greymon beaten. Also, am I the only one who thinks these shots of Greymon create the illusion that his eye sockets are empty?
This parrot wouldn't boom if I put 4,000 volts through it!
I digress. Just when all hope seems to be lost.
Tai grabs the whistle and best moment in the entire movie.
Or at least it would be if the soundtrack would shut the fuck up.
The original Japanese version had little to no music playing whatsoever. The music they added to the English dub isn't bad, but in the original Japanese version there wasn't any music playing when Tai blew his whistle. And after watching the Tri-series, I'm only realizing now how much of an impact it would have been if there was no music playing during that at all. And maybe a longer pause before Greymon opened his eye. Furthermore, every moment in this movie is either someone talking, Kari's voiceover narration, some background noise, or the film's soundtrack. There are little to no silent moments in the entire movie that last longer than 5 seconds. It barely gives you a chance to breathe. Never to the point where it gets obnoxious and annoying like The Magic Voyage or Felix the Cat movie. But at the same time, it never lets you absorb anything that happens. I know this was targeted for kids, but kids need quiet moments too. It teaches them to be patient and to appreciate atmosphere. Kids can absorb information just as well as adults can, too. But I digress. The whistle wakes up Greymon, who then fries Paramon to Kingdom Come.
And that's how you skin a cat. Bird, I don't care.
Greymon!
Wow, that's a new record. That silent moment lasted 2 seconds. At least it gave us a few seconds to absorb the awesomeness that just happened. But anyway, Tai and Kari wake up the next morning finding Greymon and Paramon missing and completely dumbfounded on what just happened that night.
And that was Digimon the movie, and I fucking love it. Everything from the animation, the action, the voice acting, direction, the editing and pacing could have been better, but other than that... Wait a minute. The movie's still going. 4 years later? Oh, yeah, I forgot to mention.